Hello, everyone. Welcome back to the 62nd ever episode of the Iced Coffee Hour. I'm Jennette, and so far from this podcast, they've made $72,994.98.
Oh, wow. My gosh.
And you were worried about doing this?
My heart's still going.
Why?
Because I thought I would get it wrong.
I think that was the terrified. Best one that we've ever seen on the entire
I think you'll find it wasn't, because I think my eye contact was a little like wonky.
You oh, that's that. Okay.
The voice was a little shaky.
It was perfect.
You're good at this. It's almost like you've acted before.
It's almost like I was forced into it as a child and am now still very stressed out by it.
Wow. Well, at least you could do amazing intros.
Well, thank
you so much for coming down here. We're all the way back in Los Angeles today to be able to do this podcast. Really happy to have you on.
Thank you.
You started acting at, well, I'm telling you this. You started acting at 8 years old. You were in iCarly.
Started at six, actually.
6 years old. Wow. 6 years old.
Little Bean.
iCarly. Then what was the other? Sam and Cat. And now you have the Empty Inside podcast.
I do. Yeah. And you were on it.
Yes.
I don't know if it will have aired, if that episode will have aired by the time this airs, but thank you so much for coming on.
Yeah, no, thank you. I thank you for coming back on here. One thing that surprised me was you sent me a DM on Instagram.
Yeah.
Gosh knows how, like 8 months ago, 9 months, I never saw it. And then we were at sushi,
yeah.
And then I sorted by top. I don't know, I was bored at sushi. Sorted by top, saw your message, realized I missed it.
Okay.
Got back to you. You got back to me. And now here we are. What surprised me was that you were into personal finance.
Yes, I have been, well, it started with sort of actually a financial anxiety from an early age. And that led me to just thinking money would solve a lot of problems. And I was always obsessed with making money, and eventually that kind of led into something of a personal finance interest. But that's definitely been more, the personal finance aspect has been more recent.
Got it. At what age did you start realizing that money was a thing? I would imagine it would be at quite a young age.
Well, I was largely the financial support for my family, so quite literally I was hearing, you know, my parents, my mom specifically, talking to me about how I needed to kind of make this acting career work so that I could help the family. And I definitely understood, like anybody who says that money can't solve problems, I don't think that's true at all. I think it can help many problems, not all, but many. And that was kind of my mindset from an early age, and definitely fueled my acting career, just knowing that I had to like help support my family.
So what was the financial situation like then before you started being like the primary breadwinner of the family?
My dad was always working two to three jobs at any given time. And my mom would basically pick up shifts at Target, or it really was just Target. There was nowhere else. She would pick up shifts there. And I just remember constant stress, constant arguments about money, constant, you know, my mom was quite erratic and kind of just like screaming and wailing and crying about not having enough. And I remember thinking like, well, this is not going to work, and I don't want this for my future, and I don't want this for my family. And so when she put me into acting, I kind of got the message and understood the mission and just was like a little kind of soldier.
And how old were you when you realized that the money was so important and you guys needed it?
I think it was probably when I was six, when my mom put me in acting.
That's crazy. Cause I know when I was six, I was not even considering money whatsoever.
Really?
I was 6 years old. No, I was thinking about like, I don't know what people do when they're six. I was thinking about how far I could kick the kickball on like the field. I don't know. What about you, Graham?
I was always into it, but I loved dinosaurs back then. I loved dinosaurs, insects, reptiles, like all of that. So my thinking was that like, I really wanted a chameleon as a kid.
Okay.
And so like, obviously you go to the pets, there's like $60. So you kind of think in your head, like, okay, if I save, you know, my grandma's Christmas money, I got a birthday coming up, I could do a few things, I could pick up pennies off the floor.
When you were six?
Yeah.
Wow.
That makes sense to me. I feel like there's certain people whose personality you just like either latch on to that or not. Except yours seems smarter.
Yeah.
Like yours doesn't seem anxiety based.
No, it was not anxiety based. It was always from the perspective of like, I love collecting things.
Yeah.
And so for me, money was something that like you could kind of collect, but I also collected lizards and like all that sort of stuff. So anything that revolved around that would tie back to money.
I love dinosaurs too. Just got to throw that out there. So
what was your favorite dinosaur?
I don't know the names, but the one with the long neck that's like supposed to be nice.
Oh.
Brontosaurus, is it?
Oh.
No, it's not.
It has a long, it's a long.
Yeah. Going back to you, did you get to keep this money, or did all, I'm curious about like the dynamic of how that worked.
Right. Well, there's a thing called the Coogan account that actually takes, or is supposed to take 15% of your money off the top and kind of put it into the child's account so that they can have at least 15% of their money by the time they're 18. And the rest of the money is kind of up for grabs. But I got these papers that were saying that like the Coogan account information was never properly filed. I got that in my 20s. So that was kind of a little bit of a shock because I really have no idea kind of what was happening. And, you know, my mom was in control of everything. So I don't think I ever saw the Coogan account money, but.
Is the Coogan account something that the show like establishes, or is it something that like the family is relied upon to establish?
It's the union. So the Screen Actors Guild says that, you know, I think it started with Gary Coleman, who was an actor, a young actor on a show called Different Strokes back in, I think, the 70s. And his parents took all of his money.
Yes, I remember that. Yeah. That was a big thing. And he was working as a security guard.
Yes. Yeah.
A while. I felt so bad.
Right, yeah. Right. Yeah. Happens to a lot of people.
So it just a lot of young actors. It never got set up, the Coogan account.
I don't think so, but to me I'm like, well, is that possible?
How would because it not, isn't if it
it has to be like I'm really unclear and the documents were pretty wordy.
But still, so. I mean it's been several years since then and you haven't seen any of the money from iCarly.
No. I definitely made enough that by the time I was on iCarly I was 14 and then I actually did the spinoff when I was 20. So at that point my mom had gotten very ill and I was fully in charge of my finances by then. So I've definitely tried to be as kind of as smart as I can be about my finances since I took them over.
Yeah, 15% doesn't seem like enough, though.
That's
no,
what I'm thinking.
That seems low.
No, 15%?
For sure. Yeah.
Especially if it's something that you weren't self-motivated in doing. Like you were like, if you were forced into.
Which is, I think, the case for like 90% of young actors.
Yeah. I wouldn't be surprised.
I remember a lot of frowns on those little faces. Like,
really?
I don't think people were stoked to. I think it's a weird business. I don't think kids love it.
It's almost like exploitation, unless the children are really into it, unless they're like, that's all I want to do, and bet
you
that
can spot
exists.
Them, well, for sure, but you can spot them a mile away, because they come in like tap dancing, and they've like got a big smile on their face, and they seem so, I remember like for commercial auditions, sometimes kids would just seem so bubbly and excited to be there, and I remember feeling so uncomfortable, and usually there were a couple other kids there who seemed as uncomfortable as I did.
But if you can tell, wouldn't the kids that weren't so motivated and excited not get the parts?
Well, it depends on the job, the role. Like, I got a lot of really sad kid roles. Like, a lot of guest episodes of, you know, Law and Order or you know, Judging Amy, Without a Trace, the really sad children.
Oh, my God.
But then I wound up not playing a sad child for a long time, so go figure.
Yeah. Was there ever a point, though, where you're just like, I don't want to do this, I don't want to go in this role? Or was it forced? Was it forced on you? Like, hey, we got to pay the bills. We got to take this role.
That's a good question. I remember I would cry on several occasions when it just felt like it really got to be too much. And I'd tell my mom, I don't want to do this anymore. But she would either say like, Net, you don't mean that, or she'd say, well, we need this. So there were kind of two different arguments that she would, you know, hit me back with, and then I'd feel guilty. You know, would keep doing it.
Yeah, I remember. I mean, it's definitely not on the same scale at all. This is a terrible comparison, but I remember my dad, my mom and dad both really wanted me to take piano lessons, and I was good at piano, and I liked playing the piano. I just hated the lessons because the teacher would make me do the scales, and I hated the scales, and I hated sight reading music. And I remember the same thing. I would be like screaming and crying because I was like maybe 4 or 5 years old because I didn't want to go to piano lessons.
Yeah.
And so my parents would bribe me. Back then it was Tamagotchis. They'd be like, we'll get you a Tamagotchi if you go to piano lessons. And so then I'd go, but I'd hate it. But looking back now, I wish I had stuck with it.
Really?
Yeah.
When did you stop? How old were you?
Six or seven.
So you did it for a couple years.
I did it for a couple years.
It feels like so long at that age. That must have felt like, I mean, that was like almost half your life.
Yeah. I just don't think I understood the benefit of like, looking back now, I could see like, sight reading music would be awesome. Knowing the scales would be essential for playing music. But back then I just couldn't conceptualize. I just would hear Mozart or Beethoven and be like, I want to play that, but never realizing how the scales play into that. So
sure.
something at least for me. I regret that.
I look back on it sometimes and I wonder.
But first, I want to thank our sponsor, Grammarly. Recently, I've been shopping for a home here in Vegas, and I gotta say, I'm super excited. I want a place that I can really call my own and where I can walk around in any shirt without getting completely roasted by my friends. But what I've realized is through the home buying process, there are tons of emails and texts that need to be exchanged. I want to make sure that when I communicate with my realtor, my messages come across clearly and concisely, especially since this is one of the biggest purchases of my life. This is where I'm so grateful that I have Grammarly Premium. It's almost like having a professional writer reviewing my sentences without feeling any of the judgment. I love how Grammarly Premium makes clarity suggestions to make sure my sentences are easy to understand and free of unnecessary or redundant words. And also their vocabulary suggestions help me avoid overused words to make sure my sentences sound exactly how I want them. Whether it's for school, work, or personal projects, Grammarly Premium is the perfect tool to help you improve your writing. And with their desktop editor, browser plugin, and mobile app, it has never been easier to revise my writing wherever I go. Do more than just spell check. Say what you really mean with Grammarly Premium. Get 20% off Grammarly Premium by signing up at grammarly.com/iced coffee. That's 20% off at grammarly.com/iced coffee. Thank you to Grammarly for sponsoring this episode and back to the podcast.
You know, I wish that I was able to look back on it and have more of a like, well, it's really cool that I did that and that I had, that I have, you know, financial security because of it. But the financial security aspect is the thing that I'm most grateful for. But otherwise, I just think it really was pretty damaging for me. And I find it difficult to be grateful for, but I wish that I had more gratitude about it.
Yeah. So how do you treat your finances now today?
Actually, when I was 21 and I was kind of in the midst of, at that point, I had just started the spinoff. I had a financial advisor and a business manager. I had a business manager and then the business manager introduced me to a financial advisor. As of the beginning of this year, I got rid of the business manager and the financial advisor. I'm very happy with that decision.
When did you do that?
January of this year.
January, there we go.
Yeah.
I think we talked about this on your podcast, which, by the way, we'll link down below in the description. I think we're posting this at the same time. So if we link this up, you go in the description, it's right there.
All right. Got rid of them in January, and I had been considering it for a couple years. I was always a little bit unclear of what exactly the business manager was doing. And once I really got to the bottom of it this year, I was like, oh, they're basically, if I email a question, I get charged to ask them anything, even though they initially said that you can ask them anything. And then also, they just kind of pay bills and I can set everything up on auto pay. So it's not really that beneficial. And then the financial advisor also took a percentage, and I felt like that was a bit unnecessary. So I got rid of both of them. And now my boyfriend's dad is actually quite good with finances. So he kind of helps walk me through everything and, my various accounts. And
it's easy. Financial managing, I think certain people I think would need one. If you're totally just like you want to remove yourself from that entirely, you don't have the self-control, or you get too emotional over your investments.
Yes.
A financial advisor, in my opinion, is really about getting in between you and your emotions. Mm. Some people just can't do it. They'll just see their portfolio go down 20%, be like, all right, I'll sell it. Mm. And then they'll wait, and it starts going up. Be like, no, it's too expensive. And then once it starts like skyrocket, okay, bye. Like those people need it, because then you have that intermediary that's like, hey man, let's cool it down. Just hold it. And they're worth that 1%. But to set up the investments for you and be like, okay, we're investing today in the S&P 500. It's just not worth it. So I'm happy you did that.
Thanks. Well, and also when I looked at my portfolio, because I had first started kind of taking a more intense interest in personal finance at the beginning of the year, and I was feeling like my allocation was way off. I was in like, this is going to sound crazy, but like 50 stocks, 50 bonds.
50.
Wow.
50. Yeah.
That's a lot. That's a lot of money in bonds.
Since I was 21.
Why? What since did you ask this guy? We should confront this guy.
Yeah, we got to have him on the podcast.
You know what?
Man,
I would pay whatever his fee is. I would pay it just to ask him these questions. I bet he had a reason.
How old was he? Was he really old?
No, he was in, I would say he was probably 40s. And I will say, in his defense, I was very, scared of any That's sort of investing early on. But the reason why I ultimately left him was because several times over the course of the past few years, I was vocal about like, hey, I've kind of changed my tune. I'm getting into this a little bit more, and I think this is unreasonable. I want to change this up. And those adjustments weren't really made. And I don't know if it was kind of maybe he had some fear around the situation last year and everything, but so that's ultimately what.
Yeah, last year was the worst time to be in bonds. The worst time. You know what? I have a feeling he probably talked to you and you said, I want to play it safe.
Yeah, for sure.
I'm getting all spooked in the market. And they're like, okay. And they go based on that.
No, you're totally right that the financial advisor, it was definitely at my he was basing it off of my emotions early on. Yeah. But I do think that when somebody says, hey, I've changed, I want to adjust this, they should be able to adjust.
But you know what they should do? If you said that, you got to be like, hey, listen, not meaning to be rude here, but you're wrong. We gotta play it. But you know what? Yeah. But that could go either way. Because imagine this, like right before COVID hit.
Yes.
He's like, you're wrong. We're going to go all in stocks. And then the account drops 40%.
Right.
You're going to go off on him and be like, you told me to do that. You lost me money. Yeah. And that's a lawsuit. So it's like a fine line. I don't know. I would be very convincing. I'd just be like, you can't do that. This is stupid. We're going to go all in on stocks, GameStop, AMC, and Dogecoin. All in. we're gonna make a lot of money.
So do you have a financial advisor and you just tell them what to invest in and they just do that for you? Because that seems like it wouldn't help at all.
No.
I think financial advisors are inherently more hands-on than, right?
Yeah, well, you have two. So you have one that's a fee-based advisor. So they just, they're a flat fee and they just give you recommendations. Yeah, okay. Those are the best. Those are the ones you want. Hmm. Just like a flat, like here's $500, or it could be, you know, whatever it is.
Ooh,
the fee-based advisors, yeah, they're the ones you want to go
Not
for.
Right.
The ones that get a percentage are the ones you want to avoid, because sometimes they'll get a percentage of selling you certain things. So I'm not saying this is what happened, but sometimes they'll get commissions, and some of the commissions could be higher on certain mutual funds. Like maybe they get a 2% commission selling you a bond, versus the other guy is getting a flat $500, no matter what they have you buy into. So you always want to go fee-based if you're going to do something like that.
Got it. I mean, that sounds great.
Yeah. And he took a percentage from you?
Yes.
Was it 1%?
I believe so, but then there's also like additional for specific bonds or stock, whatever. There's like additional fees that kind of crop up. Because that's the thing is every single year, I know what I was paying my business manager and financial advisor. Then at the end of the year, I'm getting the statements and I'm going, well, this isn't what I was quoted. This doesn't match. Why are these numbers not adding up? And it's always, well, you know, additional blank. And I'm like, well, I didn't realize that was whatever.
So they're going to take a flat 1% off the top, let's just say. And then the fees you're paying on those funds could be like another 0.5%,
right.
Let's just say. So the total you're paying now, let's call it, you know, 1.75%. Let's 1.5%, let's just say. That's probably what you were about paying.
Mm.
But that 1.5% keeps adding
That's
up,
crazy.
especially on a down year. Imagine you're down 8% and then you're down another 1.5% because of that, regardless of how your portfolio is doing.
And with the bonds, especially if you do inflation plus the 1% that they're taking, I feel like you'd actually be genuinely losing money between the two. If you're in bonds with the 50%.
Yeah.
I remember looking at my account and thinking like, huh, I feel like this should have raised a little bit more, but
it could have been a lot worse. I mean, if you were in your like 40s or 50s,
oh my God.
It would be harder to recover than that than like right now. It sucks, but like you'll be just fine.
Also, you know, to be sure, I was 21 and definitely would have been completely overwhelmed by anything personal finance related at that point. There were plenty of other things on my mind, so I think it was worth it for the years that I had it.
We did well regardless.
Yeah, and listen, 50% bonds plus like a 1.5%, like if that's the worst, then you're fine.
Oh,
what is the worst money mistake you've made?
Having a business manager. Okay. Although, I mean, they were super nice. They were very, very nice. They were very nice people.
Imagine if they're rude on top.
Yeah,
they take your money and you're like, this it. All right, bye.
Oh, I have something that you will not like at all. Yeah. I owned a house for 3 years and I didn't like that experience at all. So I sold. I made a very little amount of money. On the sale, but I hear constantly, you got to buy a house. That's the thing. Why aren't you doing that? You're crazy, whatever. And I'm like, well, I had one for a couple of years and that experience was, you know, it was more maintenance and upkeep than I expected.
Let's walk through that. So
all right.
When did you buy a house? What area? What price?
2013 in Studio City.
Good time to buy.
I think it was like $895,000.
House?
Yeah.
It's fantastic.
Yeah, that's like
gosh.
Really
okay,
good.
So you did. It sounds like you did well on the buy. Was it in the hillside of Studio City or like the?
I'm so out of that.
Ventura?
It was on. It was not like in the Laurel, before Laurel Canyon.
Got it. Okay. On the hillside, or the other side.
A hillside.
South of Ventura?
It was on a hill. It was on a hill.
Great. Okay. So that was a good buy. What got you off guard there?
Well, I intentionally went in thinking I want something turnkey. I want something that's very low maintenance. Like I don't know about fixing up and that's not my thing. And so I got something that I thought was turnkey and then wound up there. It was like encroaching another property.
Ooh,
so had to pay that and then had to do work on like the underbelly of the house. So not even cosmetic stuff, but just like redoing plumbing and piping, whatever. And then the shower leaked from the top floor onto the couch. So then had to get all new furniture, had to fix the bathroom. A stair fell off. So I had to get the stair, like just, it felt like a lemon.
When was it built?
Very recently. I think it was built like 1992, like way. Right?
Yeah, it sounds kind of fishy.
Did you do an inspection? Inspection.
Yes. Yeah.
How didn't they know about the encroaching?
I think they found that in the inspection, but then somehow it was my responsibility. Does that make sense? That's
yeah,
not right.
Yeah. So okay. Here's, if you're encroaching on another property, that would be disclosed to you. It's rare that a seller would not know about something encroaching, especially if they've lived there for a long time and not had any awareness of it. How did that come to light to you?
Through my realtor. And he had said that I would be responsible.
Okay. So you were disclosed prior to closing.
Maybe.
Okay. You would have been.
Okay.
I want to say
okay.
95% certainty. You were disclosed that ahead of time. So you're encroaching. So what did you have to do to fix that? Did you have to fix that?
Paid the person who lived above me that I was encroaching. Right?
You can. Most of the time, it doesn't even matter.
Okay.
Because if you're, are you a hillside?
Yeah.
Just going up?
Yeah.
And I'm guessing your fence was a little bit too much on their property?
Yeah, it was literally like
a
foot.
Yeah.
Like something very, very small.
Usually, you just let that be. Usually, you're just on good terms with the neighbor.
I definitely paid them, for sure.
Can I ask how much?
I don't remember, but I want to say $30,000.
That's too much. Yeah. Because here's the thing. I mean, my thought is that...
God, that is not a good reaction.
Here's the thing. Like
that's it's a lot.
These properties here, you have like usable lots. Like if I'm going a foot on this side, that's a foot in my front yard. I mean, that's usable. But hillside like that, you can't do anything with that anyway. It's not going to affect like how much you could build or where you could put like a pool or anything like that. I mean,
totally.
Maybe. But most of the time, it's not even worth it. So they just let that be. Especially hillside. It's really difficult to get it down, especially to the foot. I don't know. Usually, you ignore that unless the neighbor's like, I'm suing you. Mm-hmm. I want that back. At which point you're just like, okay, well, I'll just move the fence down.
Right.
And then it's done.
Well, it seems like the neighbor probably was not on good terms because, I mean, they wouldn't have.
Did they know it was you? And did they think that they could just get money from
Well,
you?
So I think a concern and something that definitely my business managers and my realtor, everybody kind of tried to protect me on was like, well, we got to get ahead of this just in case they should recognize you because then they might try to do something later on.
Oh, they're lawyering you.
That's
the thing. Yeah, they lawyered you,
which is
good and bad.
For sure, I really appreciate it on the one hand, but on the other, it's like I wonder how many of those expenses were sort of unnecessary, and I wish I would have been who I am now, where I would have asked more questions and kind of gotten to the bottom of it myself. But I wasn't there then.
So they were basically the ones to be like, we see this issue,
right?
We're gonna have to, but
let's get ahead of it.
I've seen this happen a lot of times with people that are in the public eye because they're so prone to lawsuits. Like if anything happens, they're like, oh, that was Jennette. Ooh, we could sue now and we could get our name out there. So they try to prevent a lot of those things.
Yeah.
But in doing so, it ends up costing more money. So realistically, I mean, it probably wouldn't have been an issue, but at least you're safe. You have the peace of mind.
Totally.
Okay. But the other issues, I mean, that's just over 3 years. I feel like that's just a part of home ownership, unfortunately.
So you think that those are like reasonable amounts of issues? Like to me, it's felt like so many issues.
It was right after you bought it too. And after the inspection, like you said,
some of that stuff happens.
Did you sell the house because you didn't want to have to deal with all of the things?
Yeah, I did.
Are you happy now that you sold the house?
Truly so happy.
Wow.
I absolutely love, I am in an apartment. I love renting. I love that anything that goes wrong, I can just shoot off an email. It's fixed the next day or within the week for sure. The ease of it. I love just being able to get up and go. Not that I couldn't do that with the house, but it felt like there was always something that I had to kind of half have my mind in the house for when I was traveling. I love it. I'm definitely not, unless you guys say that I should go get a house today.
We'll talk about that.
I like this.
What did you sell the house for?
I think it was like barely above maybe 900.
Why? Why so? How did, I feel like if you bought in 2013, sold in 2016.
Yeah.
Why wasn't it higher?
I don't know.
Because, yeah, after realtor fees, I mean, you're getting out basically break even.
Yeah.
The benefit to that, though, well, you know what? I mean, you would have made money. It would have been cheaper than renting. Mm-hmm. Built some equity in the house.
Yeah, for sure.
So, I mean, yeah, between renting, you did better.
Yeah, it was way cheaper than renting. And honestly, just I think the experience was worth something of like, well, I've done that. So now I can know going in what I did like, what I don't, what I did like, what I didn't like.
Yeah, so far these mistakes don't seem that bad. I mean, it's not like you're losing money. The fee, fine, you know, so be it. Not making a ton of money in your house, I mean, it's not that bad.
And the bonds, I think the bonds would be another big mistake.
But again, it's not the end of the world. It's not that big of a mistake.
You're still so lucky that you still have like money from, or you still see money from the work that you did.
Well, this makes me so happy.
Yeah.
Like, this is really, a lot worse. That's impressive, yeah.
No frivolous expenses. What about a car? Like buying...
I don't own a car. I don't have a car. I don't lease. I actually... My boyfriend has a car that he bought outright. It's just like a Prius from, I don't know, kind of an older Prius. And I use that when I need to. But otherwise, I don't have a car.
Graham is so proud of you.
And I like the Prius. I gotta say, the Prius has been one of my... I wanted to get a Prius, but we got a $1,000 Volvo instead.
Okay.
Love that car. Wow. But the Prius would have been... the Prius prices, by the way, have gone through the roof right now.
Really?
All used cars right now are just going insane.
Wait, why?
There's shortages.
Oh.
So they're not shipping as many cars in right now. And there's so much demand for cars, for some reason, used cars, that people are offering now like 20% over MSRP just to buy a car.
You think there's more demand, or is it the same demand, but it's just lower supply?
I don't know. I feel like there's more demand. Now I feel like people are like FOMOing in almost to get a car, to get a house. They're FOMOing to buy anything right now. Watches too. People are like, oh, the watches are going up in value right now. So everyone's trying to buy a watch. Because you're seeing people double their money.
Right.
There's one AP that Federico was telling me about that's now selling for double MSRP. It's like an $80,000 watch, but people are willing to pay
new,
like $80,000 new, but people are willing to pay $160,000 for it just because they want to skip the line because there's so much demand.
Wow.
It doesn't make sense to me. It doesn't make sense.
Love watches, right?
Yes.
Is this a fancy watch?
Yes and no. So this is a vintage Zenith El Primero A386 from 1969.
Wow. Sounds fancy.
Yeah. So this actually used to be my grandpa's watch. So this is the watch that like really got me into the whole Zenith thing. So yeah, so this was my grandpa's.
Okay.
He had, back then, he got this as a gift in the early 1970s. He did something for Zenith. I don't understand exactly what he did. Got this as a gift, never wore it, kept it in a drawer. It almost got thrown out when he passed away. And I just happened to be at the house, happened to see a box, happened to open it up, and there was this watch. Didn't know what it was, how much it was worth. I just thought it was really cool. I put it on, didn't even work because it had been just sitting in there. So the whole movement had seized up. So I got it serviced and the dude was like, wow, I can't believe you got this watch. It's in perfect condition. And I've worn it ever since.
Wow. It looks like a, kind of like a Neapolitan ice cream.
Those it little, does. Yeah, no, it's got the three, know? Yeah, it's got the three colors.
Yeah.
And that's, it's the tricolor dial, they call it. But yeah, that's a signature look for Zenith.
Do men know, are like watches the equivalent of, I don't know, Chanel, Gucci for women? Like, is it a thing that you find a lot of men know a lot about, or is
I wouldn't say a lot of men know. Okay. Or maybe it's just my aged people. They don't really care about watches. But
I feel like they do. I don't know. Really?
Well, my friends don't. No, I don't think so. I'm only 22.
Okay.
So a lot, yeah, it's just, I feel like as you get older, you get taste for expensive things. I'm not really sure.
Maybe. I don't know. I've always been into watches, but I like the value behind it.
Sure.
So that's what I'm all about, is like, which watches could you get that you would be able to own for free and then maybe make some money on?
Totally.
Do you have taste for expensive things like Chanel purses and stuff like that?
Well, because I grew up not very, you know, we were always just struggling to make ends meet. I definitely don't have... a taste for like expensive clothes or bags. I got a Gucci bag as a gift for like a season wrap gift.
Mm-hmm.
And I got some fancy black heels, Christian Louboutin. I hope I'm saying that right. I don't know if I'm saying that right. I know how to spell it though.
Louboutin. Yeah.
Some Christian Louboutin heels that are great. And I will say like I've had them for 12 years. So they're wonderful in that sense. But I don't think I've spent more than $150 on an item of clothing myself.
That's really good. That's still fantastic.
Yeah. So how much would you save in of income every month? You got to be saving like 80% plus at this point.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. My rent's fairly, you know, my rent's reasonable and I split that with my partner as well. And then what's my second highest, expense from that since getting rid of the financial advisor and business manager is insurance.
God, that's got to feel nice.
Yeah.
I got to say, I miss the simple days when it was just like, no mortgages, no nothing. I there's something about it that now, like, mentally in my mind, just having things and payments and stuff, it does bog you down. And I do fantasize, like, what if I just paid off all the mortgages? Just get rid of them. I'm not going to do it. I mean, it doesn't make logical sense, but mentally, there's got to be something freeing about that.
I 100% think so. For my personality type, it works for me, and I definitely feel much more at ease than I used to, just being able to kind of go over everything each month and see very simple numbers and not a lot of them. It's helpful.
So what are you saving for? Or is it just you have excess money, you're not going to spend it, you're just going to save it? It's financial security?
Yeah, just for financial security. Because I quit acting, I wasn't sure how long I would need that money to last me. I was kind of transitioning careers and working toward, I want to eventually be a director and a full-time writer. But in that process, I was terrified because I'm going, well, what if it doesn't work out? What if things, you know, what if they don't work out and I just have to kind of make this money last the rest of my life? How am I going to make that happen? Terrifying. But so that was definitely when I started taking more of an interest in finance in general, and when I start kind of going over all the numbers and trying to understand better to see, well, how long could this money last me? But then actually recently I sold a book and things seem to be kind of going in the right direction for my new career. And that's a huge relief also, because now I don't feel like such an urgency of, oh, well, I need to keep this number as low as humanly possible each month so that it can last me until I die. Now it's like, oh, there will be other money coming in, other opportunities. This is not my whole life, you know, money.
Are you familiar with the whole financial independence movement? I feel like you should be if you're into that.
It's retiring by 30 or
earlier. No, it's financially independent,
fire
retired
or
early. Yeah, the okay, fire movement. Yeah. What you're describing sounds to me like lean fire.
Yeah.
Well, lean fire.
It's called lean fire.
It's when you have like a worth or something under a certain amount, right? Or you want to live off of like less than a certain
amount. I believe
lean
fire should be under like $35,000, $40,000 a year. If that's what your spending is, I believe, well, maybe they even just call that fire at this point. I don't know. Maybe lean fire is under that. But like their mentality is that if you have $1 million invested, you'd be able to live off of $40,000 a year the rest of your life without running out of money.
Wow. Okay.
So it's just called the 4% rule. Which just suggests however much money you have invested, take 4% of that. That's how much it is. Now,
it's designed to run out. The 4%.
No, it's designed to have a high probability of not running out during your lifetime. So it's considered a success if you die and you have like $1,000 left over. That's a
huge success.
Yeah. That's
great.
Big success. But yeah, but the goal is that it should last a lifetime. It's not to basically keep your money the exact same with inflation.
It's interesting because I believe you like the fire movement. You subscribe to it.
Yes.
But also I've heard you talk about how much you love work and how you can't imagine kind of not working. So how do those two things go together? Because isn't the intention of the fire movement to stop working?
No, it's not. It's to get to the point where you don't have to worry about the expenses. Like you have the option to do whatever you want. And know that your lifestyle is paid for. So I like probably once a month, I'll just tinker with the numbers. I'm like, well, if I paid this off, it would be good.
Yeah.
The hard part now is two mortgages between this and the Las Vegas place that just skews the numbers really heavy.
Sure.
But yeah, no, it's just about, at least for me, knowing that if everything were to stop tomorrow, that everything would be paid for. And then I add up like how much I could spend on like other stuff. Right now it's really just aquariums. That's my biggest expense right now. Like
really,
it's not
expense.
Yeah. It's not like, you know, housing, food, like the essentials.
Yeah.
It's the aquarium. So I was kind of budgeting in my mind like how much could I spend on the aquarium?
Huh. That's such a fun one.
It is.
I actually I like spending money on vacations.
Ooh.
That's a complete waste. That's terrible.
Ooh, tell us where?
I just went to Kauai.
Okay.
That was really fun. I mean, and you know, I'm not staying at the Four Seasons or anything, but I stayed at the Kauai Beach Resort. Mm-hmm. It was a great time.
We gotta do something like that. We gotta do something like
that. It's so difficult to take time off. Like I get anxiety thinking about taking more than
really?
2 days off. Yeah, 2 days.
2 days.
That's the most that I could take off without like feeling press that I got to do something.
And why is it, what's at the root of it? Is it like because you have to blank? Like what's
It's 3 videos a week on the main channel.
Yeah.
And I'm always 1 to 2 videos ahead.
So what if you got 8 videos ahead? Is that possible even?
No.
So
no.
With your current schedule, it's not possible to get enough ahead that you could do.
A lot of it's based off current events. Well, shoot. And stuff like that.
Right.
So I'm always, I like being a video or two ahead because then I can move them around. Like if a pressing topic comes up, I know I can get it out the next day.
Got it.
Yeah. So when Friday comes around, I always have the Monday done and sometimes I'll have a Wednesday done. Mm-hmm. So just knowing that like Sunday I could start planning out a Friday video. So I always like to be a few ahead. So it's hard to take a weekend and then, you know, get back on Sunday night and be like, I don't have a video to post on Monday. Because I've kept that schedule for over four years. I don't want to break it quite yet.
Why? And that's just because of, is it integrity or why don't you want to break it? Or is there a fear of something changing?
Potentially the algorithm. Okay. I felt like I've worked so hard to get this algorithm like up and running.
Yeah.
And you've built up that snowball effect that if you stop it, even sometimes if you miss an upload, like sometimes if you stop that might impact the next subsequent videos.
Mm.
Like we've had, what I found is that 2 bad videos in a row that do not perform well throws off the algorithm for like a month.
Really?
Yeah. So when you start looking at that and be like, okay, the opportunity cost of missing 2 uploads or having 2 bad uploads in a row, that could be 20%. That's X amount. Is it worth the X amount to take a vacation? Probably not.
Do views dictate your content, what you put out? Like, would you, if you couldn't see the views, if you had no access to the views, and if that didn't change income at all, would you make different decisions with what you make?
Mm-hmm.
It would, Certainly, but here's the thing, but I'm catering to an audience. So I'm not necessarily always making the content that I want to make. I'm making the content that I think, or that I see other people want to hear about.
Okay.
So imagine it like a TV network being like, okay, today we're just going to show, I don't know, about the green-eyed tree frog. And people are like, I'm not watching the green. I don't care about it. I want to see Jerry Springer. You gotta
the tree frog.
It's like you gotta give people what they want to see. And so I'll work really hard being like, okay, these are the topics that people want to learn more about. I'm going to talk about those because I'm really catering to an audience that is very interested in certain subjects at certain times. It's not just about myself.
What would you do differently then? Like what you mentioned, it's not necessarily always in line with what you want to make.
I think it's going to evolve naturally.
Really?
That's what I think.
That's cool.
I think over time, my goal is that the vlog is going to take off. Because this podcast, easy to do. I mean, we could just knock out a whole bunch of them, be out of town for a month, be just fine.
Yeah.
The vlog is something I'm planning to take everywhere.
Very cool.
So where I go, Jack will go, Alex will go. And my goal is, I want to get the vlog to 1 million subscribers. And then at that point, we can go travel. I really want to get an RV and just travel all 50 states. And just vlog it. I think that would be so much fun.
That sounds like a blast.
Mm-hmm. Go around the world, scuba dive.
You want to come?
I'm in.
Come on.
Yeah,
let's go.
I want a big RV. Like maybe Alex is driving the big car in front with a trailer. With a trailer in the back for like, you know, 3 of us, 4 of us. That's what I would love.
So this will happen once you get to 1 million on the vlog channel.
Yeah.
Where are you at
so
now?
So go and subscribe. We're
at 44 or something.
45.
44,000.
Yeah.
Like
44,900. Yeah, we're 2 months into it.
Yeah, 2 months.
2 months into it. Yeah.
Cool.
Just the algorithm on that's different because for vlogs, we're posting once a week.
Okay.
And that's holding us back. If we want to really grow the channel, we got to post twice a week on that channel. Once a week is not enough to grow a channel. So we got to figure out a way where we could start posting twice a week.
Oh.
Tell us about your YouTube channel and your future endeavors.
And the book that you wrote.
Oh.
I've been thinking about that.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
My YouTube channel just kind of initially I had a YouTube channel when I was a kid, when I was like 14, when YouTube was first a thing and like Fred was the biggest thing on YouTube. And I would wear shades because I would get so anxious, like looking at a camera.
Wait, really?
That I'd wear these big, like red, hideous, like from Target or Rite Aid or something shades. Target makes cute shades.
Can we still find those videos or no? Are they down?
I certainly hope not. And I already regret mentioning them. It's because myself at that time was so anxious and my mom was giving me so much direction that it really was just like, it wasn't, you see these kids now that are 14 and I'm like, this is so cool that the kids are using this as a way to express themselves and be themselves and find themselves. It wasn't that for me at the time. It was more just me kind of doing what my mom said. So I think I can't imagine how uncomfortable it felt to people watching who were just like, oh my God, this kid is so uncomfortable. But you know, I did it and it was a nice way to connect with fans and things. And then, stopped that kind of a few years later and, didn't do YouTube for a long time, and then started a channel again just kind of for my podcast because I wanted to do, I did audio the first year and I wanted to include a visual element just because I think it's, that's how, honestly, I watch more podcasts on YouTube than I do like listen to them through the app.
Yeah. When Joe Rogan left for Spotify, I thought like, oh yeah, you know, I'm going to go and listen to Spotify. Honestly, I have not listened to a single Joe Rogan episode, maybe one that he's had like cool guests on, but I gotta say YouTube was like where I would go for all of that.
Yep.
And it's nice. The thing with YouTube is their algorithm, that you go on the homepage and there's something you didn't know you needed to see. And it's right there. And YouTube's like, I want you to see this, this piece of content. Go and watch this. And if you don't watch it, here it is again. We're going to keep showing it to you. Oh, you clicked on it? Let me give you 10 more. That's what I like about the algorithm, that unfortunately it's just, it's not there with Spotify. Mm-hmm. So how much are you posting on your YouTube channel?
I just post whenever I post a podcast. I don't have anything else on there. I started it for the podcast, but I actually had started it prior to that I was making short films, and to put out my short films, I was like, oh, I should have a YouTube channel. Initially, I was just going to have a Vimeo, but that felt too like industry not like who's watching Vimeo. Right? Is anybody watching?
No, you're right. No, you're right. You're totally right. You're right.
Do you give a face?
No. Oh. I don't give faces. Oh, no, I don't know. Very right. Yeah. No,
I felt agreement kind of like radiating.
Yeah.
I just wanted to confirm.
Okay. I wasn't sure.
And then
I give you a face. I don't know.
It's very. You have a very kind face.
Really?
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
It's very helpful. Yeah. It's very like comforting.
Thanks. Wow.
Yeah.
You know, I feel like we should take a segue here and talk about Jack's outfit.
Don't bring it up.
This outfit's great. Can I feel the thing?
You're joking.
No.
Alex is laughing over
it. It feels so soft.
Okay. Guess what? It's not mine. This is Graham's clothes.
Jack walked in. I'm going to embarrass you. If you have this shirt here, you could come in and we'll get Jeanette's honest reaction. I won't say anything.
I would love to change out of this outfit.
Okay.
If I could put on my shirt.
So wait. So let me, not yet. Let me explain the situation here. Okay. Get your reaction.
Let's get the lay of the land.
Jack walked in with this shirt.
Okay.
I'm not going to tell you anything about it. And I said, Jack, I have this shirt that you should wear instead.
Okay.
The shirt is mine. And the jacket is mine.
Okay.
Jack put it on and we're like, oh, this is awesome. Jack looks really good. Jack is self-conscious about it.
It's just not me.
What do you think of this?
I look like a fashionista.
I said Jack looks really good.
No, I think this is great.
Yeah.
These are like rock climbing pants. I have such simple taste.
Those are Jack's pants. Those are not my pants.
Oh, these are your pants. Okay.
Yes. Yes.
Like, I have such simple taste.
Jack walked in and I said, we really got to step up the caliber of how we're presenting ourselves to guests. And it's fine if we're having our buddies like Kevin and Jeremy on. It doesn't matter. Like that's so laid back.
No.
But when we have
You're a big deal to come on.
When we have guests come on here that we've never met before, I think it's essential that we have a great first impression and that we're professional and that we offer guests coffee and that everything
great
is
coffee.
Clean. Thank you.
Yeah.
So that's why I was like, Jack, I got these shirts. They're a little too big on me. They're a little baggy. Put them on. They looked great. We all agreed unanimously. You look really good in that.
You look good.
For me, this is just weird clothing. It's just not my style.
Jack's not used to looking good.
So I relate to the feeling of like when something's not you. I mean, I'm wearing a white t-shirt for a reason. I feel like I have to wear something where I can be myself. Because if I'm like a little more elevated or something, I feel like I get more stiff and I can't like.
I'm so stiff right now. I'm so, like, this is so tight on me. I can't like, look, it doesn't even look at where it goes to. He made me wear a watch too. He's all, yeah, you got it.
I was going to say the watch is great.
Yes, I knew it.
No, what he wants is for me to turn into him. That's Jack, I used to have long hair, and every time I would show up, Graham would be like, dude, when are you going to get that cut? I get a haircut, and I'm like, yeah, cut it mid-length. They cut it just like Graham's hair. And
it looked good.
And it was
I didn't know
longer,
he got a haircut.
And you know what Graham said? He's all, dude, I love your hair, man. It looks so good, dude. And
I meant it.
Just like that.
I meant it. And listen, Jack's hair was he'd come in, the whole thing was poofing around. We're having good guests on the podcast.
Poofing around?
Yeah, what?
Dude, it looks good, man.
No, we'd have high caliber guests on the pod flying in from around the country. And then Jack would walk in with his hair all like, and it's like, we're not in college. It's like, we're running a professional pod. We want to grow the pod. We got to have a presentable professional image.
I just don't think this looks professional, to be honest. Everything is way too small on me. Even my pants are like way too small on me, dude. I can't even.
Those aren't my pants.
Up.
That's your problem.
I know. All right. I'll put on the shirt that I was wearing because I really do actually want to change out of this. I felt so weird wearing this, dude. I'm not gonna lie.
But you thought he looked good.
Yeah.
I look Swedish.
It didn't.
You look so good. Be honest. Okay. Be honest about this. Don't hold back.
So
wait. Stand, Jack. Stand. How are we gonna get a good look at you?
This is what I would have worn.
Okay. Can you can I see the pants too with it?
Yeah.
Well, let's see. Okay.
Let's get the thoughts on the Jack.
Yeah, Jack, sit down. I want you to. I had some very choice words to say about this.
Very choice. Very choice.
We all have.
I actually took a picture to show him. Like, it's
how ridiculous I look. Like, I think I look sharp. I look dapper.
I want you
to look genuine. Yeah, and
be honest, because I think constructive criticism is really important.
Oh, let me take this off too.
I guarantee whatever you say is not going to be as harsh as what I said. 100%.
All right.
This watch, guess what? Doesn't even work. It's not functional.
Purely decoration.
Yes.
I actually like the cut of, like, this style of shirt. I don't love the stripes, but I love this style of shirt. My boyfriend actually wears things like this certain times to Zoom meetings. And I'm like, I love it. I think there's something very handsome about, like, a nice collared shirt. I don't know if, like, the material is doing it for me. It looks like maybe it's cotton or something.
It's very soft.
So you're doing the criticism sandwich. So we did it. We went in with a nice thing, the bad thing, and you end with a nice thing.
I also button them up like all the way. And Graham doesn't like
you
it.
You button them all the way?
Depends.
Is it not tighter on your neck?
I just like it.
Let's see. Okay.
You just, I mean, I probably wouldn't do this one all the way, but I do my other shirts all the way. All
right.
Graham says I look like a 14-year-old boy.
Yeah. I said if you were 13, fine. You could wear the shirt. I also said it's incredibly wrinkled. Not to wear something like that. And it's just, I think it's not a professional. I don't think it's a mature look.
So I would agree that maybe there's something that looks quite youthful about the kind of like pattern and the material. But as for like this, the cut of the shirt, God, I wish I had a picture of it's possible that they're like collar shirt. The fit's good. Yeah, the fit's good.
I think it could be a little bit tighter.
Tighter.
It's too boxy.
What? I thought this was tight.
I think the shoulder fits well. Yes. I think like this area is a little loose.
Yeah, and same with the sleeves. A little loose. It's a little dad. It's a little dad.
Maybe if they were there.
Wow. You know what? If you were a 13-year-old dad, that shirt is perfect for you.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, how would you describe your style?
I don't think I really have a style, to be honest. I kind of just wear what I think looks good.
I think everybody has a style. I think maybe they don't think they have a style, but I think everybody has a style.
So I guess, I never dress up. The only time I ever dress up is for occasions like this.
Got
it's not this, I'm wearing pajamas.
This is some dressing up, by the way. I told them I want to take him to H&M and we do like a shopping spree. $150, completely redo your wardrobe.
Graham's favorite thing is to put me in weird situations and analyze me.
I think this you're going to look through his Tinder profile and I want you to critique it. I want you to critique it, give him advice.
Oh my God, so I love going through people's dating profiles and seeing what's going on.
You know what's so funny? This is our running joke here, is we look at our retention rate and it's like, you know, it's like this, you know, it goes up and down.
Yeah.
We talk about Jack's dating, just everybody. Cause here's the thing. I think the women are really interested and the guys are just like, what is she going to say? Cause it applies to pretty much everybody.
Like, no, the guys are like, Jack's killing it. Like, how can I up my game? So they listen.
How is Tinder? So is Tinder the only one you're on?
I'm on them all.
All of them. How's it going?
I haven't met with anyone in a long time, but I mean, I feel like it's going well.
Are you on Bumble? Do you do Bumble?
I'm on all of them.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm gotcha. On name anything. It's
yeah.
Like-
I don't know. For some reason, so a lot of the time I tell the girls I dropped out of college and then they ghost me. And that's,
I think that's a sign of honor. Listen, I think that's a good thing.
Girls
I dropped
don't
out.
Like it, man.
Here's the thing. I'll tell you my concerns with Jack.
Yeah.
He's terrible with getting back to people and texting. Terrible with it.
Oh, me too.
He could be really into somebody and then not respond to them for a week. And I'll be like, what happened?
Are you
really
into
it? And
yeah,
if you don't respond for a week,
yeah, but he's like, oh, I just forgot, or there was nothing to talk about. It's like, Jack,
if there's nothing to talk about, I'm not going to text someone. And then
you're thinking of them. It doesn't matter.
But I was so genuinely surprised. I like to think that I'm like somewhat socially. I like to think I'm very socially aware. But sure. I was so surprised when I didn't text this girl. I said, hey, I'm going to California. She's from Vegas.
Okay.
And I go to California, come back a week later, and I text her, hey, I'm back in Vegas. Ghost me.
Sounds like a booty call.
But we didn't even do anything the
first
time we hung out.
It's but your only reason for texting is then to meet up with her.
It's really fascinating to me, yeah, because I think there are I have a lot of male friends that are similar where it's like, well, because I was out of town, so then I'll like reach out when I'm back in town. I'm like, I want a daily text at least, even like early phase of dating, and when we're together. It's going to be a lot more than that. But
exactly, yeah, like, you gotta.
I don't know. I feel like it's.
Maybe
part of it.
That's right.
Yeah, but then Jack says, well, I don't have the time for that. I'm so busy. I got all this stuff. Just a text.
Well, also, thought is, are you feeling chemistry with these people?
I don't know. I think so.
I mean, I don't know. That's a no.
I just
yeah, that is
if
no,
it's not
true.
A fun,
no,
guess,
I, what
it's
I do
a no.
is I that's exist. True. I live my life. I wear the clothes that are comfortable. And
how's that going for you?
I liked it. I never knew there was a problem with my style until this guy came into my life and he critiqued everything I wore.
Also, he kind like of opened year. Up. Like yeah. His gestures are like more animated
when I'm wearing
now.
My favorite shirt. I love this shirt so much. When I get clothes I like,
yeah.
I put them in my cabinets and I leave them there for 6 months and I break them out on the most like the best occasions.
Whip them out for the...
This
yep.
thing I saved for probably 8 months. I was like, this is the nicest shirt. I love this shirt so much. And the other shirt that I wore before this one, when they asked me to change that one,
yeah.
was another shirt I held for probably 9 months.
Well, there you go.
Because I liked it so much.
Yeah, but imagine we have someone flying in town just for a weekend to meet with us and talk about something serious. And then, you know, we have a shirt that hasn't been ironed. It's very small tweaks. We're taking you, Jack, and we're enhancing the best parts. That's what we're doing.
Does it do the remarks ever bother you? Do you ever
no,
feel like
no, no, no.
That's
I
great.
I never feel insecure about
no.
it.
No.
No,
deep inside.
It's fine.
Oh, no, it's fine.
No, I think it's fine. I find it humorous because I'm not a very like insecure person, but yeah. I think it's really funny when he points out stuff like that because I just don't think it's a big deal.
I have so many more dating questions too for you.
Oh, God. Retention is going through the roof right now.
People
are going to timestamp go to and then whatever this is.
Like for chemistry, like who's the, have you ever been in love? Let's start there.
I don't know. I think so. I dated a girl for 2 years and 7 months and I told her I loved her.
I think if the answer is I think it's a no.
It's a no.
But
I
felt like I loved her when I was dating her.
Why did you feel like you loved her? What made you feel like you loved her?
I don't know what love is. No, I think it's because I would do whatever she wanted me to do whenever.
What?
That sounds pretty... I don't know, that sounds bad.
No, when you love someone, you do whatever they want.
No, not necessarily. What if they want you to go and do something that's destructive? What if that compromises who you are if they want you to do something like that?
I don't think you would love someone that would request something like that from you.
Or would you?
Okay.
Maybe it's not real love. If you love someone that would request something malicious of you to do. Yeah.
And what do you feel like are the qualities that you generally like
look for?
Drive, well, that you connect with the most?
I don't know.
Really?
I guess someone that's smart. I like smart people.
Sure.
I would love to date a girl that's like a genius.
He's got high standards.
I was going to say, okay,
no.
She's got to have an IQ above 150.
You asked what I like.
No, great.
Look,
it's
if
great.
She's
I love
dumb, that's okay too, but I would prefer if they were smart.
Anybody.
Is that such a weird thing to say?
What do you go for?
Anybody. Anyone that shows any interest.
Dumb as a doorknob, yeah. Genius.
If
dumb,
they like
I'm there.
Me, if they maybe consider that I'm like okay and I'm not ugly, then I like them. That's all it takes. No, that's a joke. Yeah.
That got real dark.
No. If they look at me, I like them.
You're
no,
in.
It's, I guess, like, you know, got to be smart.
Okay.
I don't like people that get angry all the time. I like girls that are
no
easygoing.
Anger management issues.
Oh, gosh, no.
Okay.
No. I'm like the most easygoing person ever. I never get angry.
I can attest to that.
I never show rage or
so
anything.
Somebody kind of easygoing. Yeah. Somebody who, like, is on that kind of... Because sometimes I feel like it's you can click with different energies. Like, if you're really easygoing, maybe somebody who's a little more whatever.
Yeah, I mean, I guess it would be nice to have someone that's more assertive. Like, if I get a chicken tender and the chicken tender isn't cooked all the way, I'm not going to say anything to the waiter. That's not me.
Oh.
But maybe if I dated a girl that would say something to the waiter, that would be maybe nice. But I wouldn't want a girl that would get mad.
Gotcha. Somebody who will ask the waiter to reheat the chicken tender, but not somebody who will throw the chicken tender across the restaurant.
That's exactly it.
Got it.
I think you pretty much summed up the
That's
girl that I'm looking for.
That's the woman for you.
Yeah.
All right.
Ideally, smarter.
Yeah, right.
With that little contingency.
I think Jack is too serious and too logical, and he needs to get rid of that.
Too serious, too logical for what?
Dating.
For dating.
No.
Not for work, not for anything.
No. Serious and logical for work, perfect. But I think what's needed for dating is totally, it's a 180 from work.
It is very difficult because I am not a very emotional person. Like, I kind of just exist. And I don't really feel many emotions. I kind of just exist.
Really?
I think we're going to analyze you, Jack. I think it's because it puts you in an uncomfortable position and you avoid those uncomfortable positions.
Do you feel emotions intensely or
do
not
I?
Intensely?
Graham feels emotions extremely intensely.
No,
really?
I don't think so. I don't think so.
Alex, you can attest to this. Yes, you can.
No, I do.
You're very emotional.
I no, I'm not. I don't think so at all.
Dude, yes, you are, dude.
Come on, man. Like, unless I get a 10 on it. Like, no, so I get emotional if I do a bad video.
That makes sense. To, I mean,
but he gets extremely emotional. You get I get ruins your night. And not only that, it's like, dude, I've seen you sad. I've seen you very angry. I've seen you feel very happy.
I get little bursts of anger sometimes, but it goes away within like 5 seconds.
Interesting. So kind of like rapid.
Yeah, it's like, oh, yeah. And that's it.
Yeah.
I'm that. That's it. Yeah. I feel like it sounds like you have kind of a low dial on your emotionality type thing. Like, I feel like I'm a 10 or I'm just a 10 of whatever I'm feeling. I mean, either it's a 10 of joy or a 10 of sadness or a 10 at whatever. But like, I don't know what a small emotion feels like. I feel them so intensely.
Maybe it's because there's very little that I care about. So if you don't care about something,
wow. What? This is blunt, man.
That's good.
Well, if you don't care about something so much,
then what do you care about?
That's a good point.
Is there anything you care about? Like, what do you care about?
Work.
Right answer.
Family.
That's true.
And my friends.
So do you get emotional about, you do get emotional about those things then?
Yes. Okay. If anything makes me sad, it's the thought of my parents dying.
Thought of your parents dying. Yes, okay.
That makes me very sad.
That can get you just sad.
Very sad.
Got it.
Yeah. Oh, and I love music. Like, music will make me happy.
So music can affect you.
Sure.
Okay.
Well, it doesn't affect me. It just makes me happy.
Just happy.
Yeah,
you
it never
don't
makes
get
me sad,
sad if you feel like a swell no. Violent.
I love like if I watch a sad movie, I'm so happy. I love it.
This is what? Just all kinds of this is confusing.
Now you know how the girls feel.
I don't understand. It's so simple to me.
No.
To feel the emotion of sadness is such an incredible thing. So like when I watch a sad movie and I feel that way, I'm like, wow, I feel.
Is it like you're happy that you're able to feel almost?
I don't know. I think I'm just happy that I can feel sad.
You're just like, wow, this is a powerful thing. Like, and it's cool that I can feel.
Yeah, exactly. I think that might be it.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's, I'd love to have that kind of like appreciation. I feel like it's so hard in the thick of an emotion to be able to see it for what it is until like, to your point, like I feel like I get out of them quite quickly and then I'll be like, oh wow. Okay. That was.
There, I think it's just, it comes down to the amount of things that you care about. And if you care about more things, like more amount of things, higher volume of things, you tend to care about each thing a little bit less. But if you care about very few things, then you care about those very few things a lot.
So it's like each person has a certain amount of caring and then it just like
there's a book
up
about
differently.
This.
What is it? I'm curious.
It's like how to not give an F. But they say quote it like you have so many Fs to give.
Yeah.
And so you can give 10 Fs. You have to choose wisely what F stands for the F word.
I think we got that.
Thanks. What do you care about?
Work is definitely high up on the list.
Yeah.
Work, family, friends.
Okay.
And the aquarium.
Yeah.
How about you?
Work, my family. I love my nieces, my brothers. My boyfriend is very, I love him so much. And friends. Work, family.
No, work, family, friends. I mean, yeah. That encompasses
some family. I don't think that just because of your family that
creates
love,
right.
You know.
But that makes sense.
My brothers are amazing.
But I'm sure that there are other things. Like, I don't think that means that you don't care about everything else. For someone like me, it's like I don't care about anything else other than those things. For Graham, he does care about other things than those things, just a little bit.
Well, you know, it's interesting because I there was a time in my life where I was really into the idea of like balance because I thought, well, maybe that would. That's what you should do is like have a balanced life. And maybe I'll try and care about, you know, health and adventure and like whatever, you know, you've seen the wheel of life type things. And I'm like, what if I try to like balance it out a little bit more? But I don't think that's how I'm wired. I think I genuinely care about work and relationship. Like those are probably the top two for me, if I'm being totally honest. And everything else is just kind of a lesser, like even friends. I don't have a ton of friends. I don't, you know, I have two kind of main friends that I talk to on a regular basis. And otherwise, I don't know. I feel like you can't really force caring about.
I agree with that.
Right?
Yeah, work, relationship, family, friends.
Yeah,
yeah. I don't think we cleared up much.
I think we made some progress.
I don't think we made any progress here, Jack. What did you learn from this? Nothing.
I learned that this actually looks better than how bad you think it looks.
I genuinely am so curious about the dating profiles. Are the pictures?
Oh,
right?
Because I think the pictures. We have everybody look through this. So we had Tiffany Ma look through this. We had Kelly Stamps look through this. You will be now the third to go through this.
I'm very curious.
Can we talk about how you came in the new relationship? Or I don't know how long you've been in a
Yeah, it's been
How did you guys meet and what has been your experience like prior to this?
Yeah, prior to this, so I've always been a relationship person, definitely like would just get in them too soon, too quick. I was in sort of two longer term relationships and probably, you know, a handful of other that were 6 months or something. I don't know. And then this one I've been in for 5 years, and we met through our mutual friend, Rami. He introduced us, and we've been going strong for 5 years.
Wow. Yeah. Congratulations.
Thank you.
5 years.
Yeah.
Macy and I are just about to hit two.
Oh, congrats.
On Tuesday.
That's huge.
Two on Tuesday.
That's
and
so that, exciting.
And 2 years will officially be the longest relationship I've ever had.
Oh, what? How does it feel?
2 years. Good.
Yeah.
Nice job,
yeah, it's
bro.
Weird. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I think the last one was like a week or two shy of 2 years.
Okay.
So it was like just barely got there.
It's
so.
I think 2 years is a big milestone. Yeah. I feel like at that point you really know the other person so well, and there's, you know, the first 6 months is such a version of the relationship, but then after that there's so many other kind of stepping stones and things that you learn and phases, and I just think 2 years is a really cool one to hit.
Yeah. So do you have plans of I don't know if this is too personal, no, like getting married or having kids and like taking that step?
So I didn't want to get married before this at all. I was always very like wary of it. And I think because of seeing my parents' tumultuous relationship, I thought that's not for me. That doesn't seem like it works. That's awful. And then after meeting him, when we started getting serious, I was like, I actually could see marrying this person. And this is somebody that I want to make that commitment with. And it feels realistic. It doesn't feel like some sort of, you know, delusional thing anymore. So that I want, and kids, I'm really not sure about. There was maybe 6 months where I thought that I wanted them, but I don't know if I want them.
Yeah.
Like, oof.
I've always wanted one. Like that, well, that has always been
so
one. No, I was pretty much raised as an only child.
Okay, yeah.
I loved it. Like, listen, so I have a half older sister,
right,
that she was, I think she was 16 or 17 when I was born. So I never really grew up with her. I loved it. I loved having it, but maybe that's like, I love having everything to myself. Whoops. I hated sharing as a kid. Like I was like, that's mine. I'm going to take that. I'm not going to share that with anybody. I brought that here. You're not going to play with it. But then if another kid is like, hey, can I see that? So it only applied to me, but I don't know. I liked it.
Okay.
I liked it. I liked all the attention of the focus, even though I like to be left alone a lot of time. Like I liked that it was just me.
I'm surprised you even want a kid.
Yeah.
Yeah, actually, I was surprised too. I would have expected no.
At one point, one kid was my goal. Macy wants two.
Okay.
I'm happy with one. We'll find, maybe it's two. That's, or, you know.
And at some point, does that mean like kind of revolving around work, like till things settle down? Or is it just such a question?
I don't know. I can't imagine it right now.
Yeah.
Like right now, I don't know how that would be feasible.
Yeah.
That's not something I want right now. But in the future.
You for sure want, wow, cool.
Yeah.
How can you know? I feel like that's such a thing. I don't know.
That you want kids?
Yeah. It's so interesting. I've also, every time I say that I'm not sure, people are like, oh, wait. It's always like, wait. When I was 21, it'd be, well, wait till you hit 23. Mm-hmm. And then it's like, wait till you hit 25. And I'm 28. They're like, wait till you hit 30. Like,
oh,
I don't know.
Yeah.
Is this
wait
okay?
Till you hit 35. Wait until you hit 50.
When you're 65, you're really going to want one.
Yeah.
I've always known I want kids. 100%.
Really?
Yeah. Many.
I would have guessed that about you.
Yeah.
How many?
Well, I've always said two, and then I heard Kevin said that he wants, you know, meet
oh,
Kevin.
Oh, gosh.
Makes YouTube videos on personal finance.
Yeah, Kevin wants
he
like
said
seven,
he wants
eight.
Like seven or eight, and I thought to myself, like, why would I not want seven or eight? And I couldn't come up with a good answer.
Really?
So maybe I'll have more. Yeah.
Seven or eight. Wow.
Are you serious? Wait, Jake, you're being serious?
Yes. Yeah, I'm being serious. Why would I not want more than two? I don't know if I would want 10.
Wait, you're saying you want up to two?
No. I used to say two, but now I'm thinking, like, why not more?
Yeah. One for me mentally would be like, that's, it's,
exhausting.
I don't know. Yeah. Cause it could, it's like, then you lose out on that freedom that just you could, you know, do whatever
right.
You stay out late one night. Something comes up, your buddies are going somewhere. All right. I'll leave.
Sure.
Like that's that sort of freedom that, I mean, maybe that's worth it, but I don't know. Why so many? Like, I think two. Two max, that's a good number, and manageable.
Sure.
And it's expensive, too.
If you can
cost.
Afford it. That would be if
cost.
I could afford it and provide a good childhood for the kids.
Right, yeah.
There's no way you could. There's no way you could give your attention appropriately to
so
many children.
If I live to be a dad, I could be a dad to several kids.
Is there any other advice that you have for Jack before we go into your stuff?
Well, are all your profiles the same?
No, I have different photos.
Okay, so I'm really curious about the different profiles.
And you want to see other photos?
Yeah, genuinely.
You can see other photos, sure.
Do you have, but is that all, there's so little writing.
Yeah.
Do you want more? I'll show you more.
So
you
can, I the biggest that I got into dating, I was on OkCupid for like 7 days and then I unsubscribed, but it was always important to me to read what they had written. Cause I can't, I don't want to, if somebody doesn't know general grammar, nothing, not like a grammar Nazi or something, but just like generally what's going on, that feels bad to me.
Sure.
How many messages would you have gotten in 7 days? Like, well, I met hundreds.
It was insane. And I tried so hard to, I went by a different name. I tried to use pictures that were really, but then I was like, well, shoot, because I have to use some pictures, but they just test if there's facial record, like they have to confirm that it's a face, and they somehow match it to like other things to make sure, I guess, that you're not using a different person's face. I was like, well, I don't want to be recognized on this thing, so how can I use pictures that are kind of shaded or kind of profile or kind of something that's not like immediately recognizable? But then I stopped after a week.
Would you have dated someone who like knew who you were and was a fan? Like with you and your current boyfriend, like did he not know? Or I guess it's through mutual friends.
Yeah, it was through mutual friends, and he had no idea. And I think if somebody was a fan, that would be, I guess, strange, just because they would have known me as a kid. So that's not me, and as a character. So then, you know, I dated somebody who would always, I used to be big into Vine. I'm sorry. And I would make Vine videos, and the guy was always like, be like you are in your Vines.
Wait, what?
Be funny. And I'm like, I mean, I'm not like on all the time. Like, I'm a person, and I like to have like conversations, and I'm not just like performing all the time or something.
Perform dance. That would be hilarious. Imagine doing that over dinner. Tell a joke.
That is terrible.
Like Vine in person.
How did you and Macy meet?
Instagram.
There you go. No kidding. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, she sent me a funny message on Instagram.
Yeah.
And I didn't think anything of it. I just thought it was a funny comment.
Yeah.
And so I just responded back to it.
Yeah.
And I said like I said ha facts. Like just no, it was a little silly comment to a story. And then she responded to something back that was also funny, and we literally just started from that. And we just kept talking.
Cool.
Yeah.
That's awesome, man. That's really cool.
Instagram.
I know, that's the way to go.
How often do you go out then? Like actual meet the person?
Oh, never. Not really ever. It's hard to get someone to want to go out with you.
Well, during COVID stuff, I'm sure it was a lot of, was it Zoom date? Or like
No.
How would that go?
Like, I mean, you just ask, like, hey, are you seeing people? Are you like safe? And then I never saw anyone because I was locked up here. So I was safe. Yeah. Yeah.
And then since then, no dates?
No, I mean, I had one, but then she ghosted me after I didn't text her for a week.
So you went out once with her.
Yeah, and it was a great date. Like I thought I thought she really was into me. Yeah, I did.
But were you into her?
She talked about her ex-boyfriend a lot.
Yeah, that's a no for me. That's you dodged a bullet.
She talked about her ex-boyfriend a lot.
So she's into you. But she talked about her
ex. My advice to her was,
don't give her, and you gave her advice
with him. Yeah, cuz
it went well.
They were so good together. I really felt like she was happy with him. And unfortunately, they had to split. And I said, you should try to pick it back up.
Oh,
what did
gosh.
You like most about her? What did you like least? From that, I know it was one date, but.
I wouldn't say there was anything specific that I liked about her, but I was just happy to spend time with someone.
We should not be laughing about this. But like,
I was really happy to spend time with someone. Like,
oh, man.
What?
But that's just such a bummer.
Yeah, that's a terrible date.
That's a real bummer.
Terrible date.
I thought she was interested in me, and that's the way that I interpreted it. And it really seemed like she was.
That reminds me of this one date. I don't know when. This must have been like almost 10 years ago that I went on this date. It must have been like 22 or 23. And I went on this date with this girl. She was nuts. Like, I knew that she was crazy from like the text messages she was like, we had never met before, and she talked about like how her friend backstabbed her by like talking about her grandma, like some weird stuff. So I knew I was going into something crazy. But I get there, and it turns out that she had a boyfriend on a date. So she had a boyfriend and was talking about like how they probably weren't gonna like work out, but she just wanted to meet other people, like just in case it didn't work out. And I left her with the bill. I've never done that. I was so...
You got up and left?
Yeah.
Well, did you say something?
No, I just left.
I have a boyfriend. You're like...
No.
Did you say, I have to pee, and then...
Yeah, something like that. No. It wasn't just like, I have a boyfriend, I'm gonna leave. She talked about having a boyfriend. Meanwhile, like all this stuff he was like doing that was bad, talking about how her friends were backstabbing her. And not only that, but she got something really expensive on the menu. Like, if I'm going out with somebody, I order like a salad, an appetite, like something reasonable. Yeah, and she just full on just ordered like a steak. And just, I think she went out just assuming that I was going to pay for this entire thing. Yeah. And like after, I was not into her.
And you go
immediately.
Wow.
Yeah. And she went off on me. I forget what she texted me afterwards. I never responded to her. And then a week later, she asked me out again. I never responded. I forget.
So was it when you initially said crazy? I'm always wary when a guy says crazy. I'm like, what did you do? Like it always.
Yeah, I get it. Usually, yeah.
But and I usually feel like there's some sort of that does sound crazy.
Yeah, but she wanted me to go back and forth of gossiping about her friend, like backstabbing her over text. I have nothing invested in this. I didn't want to go back. About, oh yeah, your friend is.
Yeah.
Like so immediately, wow. She wanted that like drama.
So yeah, totally. So early on, that's.
Yeah, but I've never done that since. But yeah, that was, I'm not going to sit there and pay $80 for a meal.
Oh man. Yeah,
but no, the other one was just cringy. I met this girl in traffic and she had her foot out the window, like in traffic on Sunset Boulevard.
Oh, literal traffic. I was like some bars.
No. Like in traffic.
Okay.
She had her foot out the window. I made a comment and I happened to get her number. Because her cars were like side by side. I just thought it was funny. She had her foot out the window. And so we start texting back and forth. And I was just really nervous. Like, I was scared to go on this date. I
You said she was like gorgeous.
I thought she was. But again, I don't remember. Like, I just saw her in her car. So like, I'm not 100% on that. But I was really, really, really nervous.
Yeah.
So before the date, and we were going to meet up for lunch. Before the date, I met up with a friend. And I thought it was a good idea to bring my friend along on this date.
Why?
Because I thought then it would be like, oh, I'm so cool that like I have a friend with me, and she'd see that like I have friends. So I thought it was just a good idea. So I show up with him, and she's obviously confused.
Yeah.
And I think him and I were just talking the entire time because I was.
Did you think because you were so nervous?
I was nervous.
Okay.
And I was just like, you know, if maybe it would be cool if like him and I are like just talking and.
Oh
it was
God.
So bad, and we basically just sat down, and I'm thinking, oh yeah, she thinks I'm so cool because of, like I got a friend here, and she gets a call or she goes, she picks up and she says, she comes back and says, hey, like my nephew ate glue, and I have to watch like his brother or something like that, so because he's going to the hospital, oh, so God. I have to go like right now, and yeah, I forget what I probably said something really stupid to that. And then I texted her again, like a week later saying like, hey, I hope your nephew's doing well. We should go out again sometime as long as your nephew doesn't eat glue again or like something stupid never gets back to me. It's just embarrassing. Really embarrassing.
Yeah. I'm not surprised by the not getting back after the friend, bringing the friend.
Yeah. How
could you do that?
Dude? I was just nervous. I was nervous. I don't think I had gone on a date. I was just, I had no idea what to say or do.
Hmm.
Yeah, I don't know. I was just scared.
I don't think I have any interesting
date stories.
Like bad what about first like dates a
crazy
or anything?
Fan?
No, I've met people with like my face tattooed on their
no.
Body. That's
that,
really
how is that not a story?
I mean,
how does that make you feel?
Bad. I mean, uncomfortable. A little bit uncomfortable.
You don't feel honored?
Well, I mean, I don't have any.
That's
tattoos,
a lot. Of, that's
so
a lot of pressure.
Like, yeah, it feels kind of.
Sure. Okay.
You know, it feels a bit much.
Yeah. That makes sense.
Is that bad to say?
No, I think that makes sense. I feel a little weird, I guess.
Maybe at the time I was honored, you know, when I first saw them or something, but it's been so
do
long.
Do they show that to you or how does that come up?
Yeah, so it's usually some sort of a signing and they'd be like, you're never going to guess. And whenever that would come out of somebody's mouth, I'd be like, I bet I can. And then it'd be sort of either lifting the shirt or showing the arm or showing the back or whatever.
That is weird because they still have it. You know,
well, I mean, they have it now. It's yeah. Like
it's been years,
I was a child. Like yeah, they got a child tattoo. They got an underage person, not a child, a teenager. They got an underage person tattooed on their body. It's a little
that is
you know,
weird. Yeah, okay,
it's
not
interesting.
I get it. That's weird.
But no, super interesting date story. I wish I had like a cool date one.
All right, so we got to talk about the book, man.
Yeah.
We got to talk about the book.
What do you want to talk about? We can talk about the book.
Sure, we can talk about the book. I was very excited about that. I just sold to Simon & Schuster, I guess, at the beginning of the year, and I just turned in my first draft, got notes back, and it will be coming out in June of next year.
What's it about?
It's called I'm Glad My Mom Died. I know it's a harsh title. It is a memoir, which also I get sounds kind of crazy because I'm only 28, but it's very much covering kind of my childhood and adolescence and being famous at a young age, my relationship with my mom, a abusive relationship, if you hadn't already guessed, and it's darkly comedic. So it's definitely not just like, there's a lot of heavy subject matter, but it's done in a comedic way that hopefully doesn't undermine the subject mm-hmm. matter, but that just makes it a little lighter and more approachable.
How do you go about writing a book? Is this something you've wanted to do, or is this something?
Yeah? This is something I wanted to do. Yeah, I wanted to be a writer since I was, like, that's what I would have chosen to do. Psychologist or writer, I think, had I not had my mom and not had that kind of her agenda for me. But prior to the book, I'd written mostly like short films, feature film, like definitely script format. But for the book, I had actually done a one woman show that already kind of had the framework and the structure built in. So I took some of that and then obviously expanded on a lot more because the one woman show was an hour and this book is, you know, much longer than that.
How do you go about writing a book like that?
I mean, every day I have a schedule set where I just, I usually don't even look at my phone before like 1 p.m. And I just, first thing when I wake up, I write as many words as I usually try to have a word count in mind. I think 1500 words a day is what I aim for. And for this, it was because it was my life. This structure was, like I said, kind of very built in. So yeah, outlining first though definitely matters.
Is it hard to write about yourself?
I find it really important to the projects that I do. I can't think of a single thing that hasn't been, there've been a few features that I've written that aren't like drawn from my life, but everything has to be drawn personally, like from a deep personal place for me at least. I find that passion or that sort of connection to the material to be so important in order to see it through to the end, because there's so many ups and downs, and it in this business is just like such a long process. Any project takes so long and there's so many hurdles to go over that like if you don't have a connection, I couldn't imagine staying invested in something if I didn't feel like there was something that I needed to sort of exercise it out of myself or something that I wanted to share with others that hopefully might connect with. I don't think it'd be possible if I was just like, you know, whipping something out of thin air that I didn't relate to in a deep way.
Yeah. That sounds fascinating.
It does.
Sounds like a really good book.
Yeah. I've wanted to do a book at some point,
yes.
But I feel like it's just, I don't know what I would probably talk about early retirement.
Yeah.
Something along those lines, but it's just even starting, it seems so daunting. So daunting to do. At one point, I want to do it. But I also feel too young. I know you.
Really?
I feel like you've had so many other experiences that you could write about. I feel like, you know, you got to be like 50 usually. Like, you have to have lived more. But you've experienced a lot.
I would disagree with that. Especially really? If you're coming. It seems like because you would want to talk about finance and all the things that you do. And I feel like there's such a gap missing. Because every time I walk past the personal finance section, it's like a 60-year-old man telling me tip. And I'm like, I don't relate to this person. I feel like you'd hit a different audience.
Maybe.
You don't think? You disagree?
Maybe because the audience is on YouTube. Like, those people under 35 are probably not reading books or probably watching YouTube videos.
I would disagree. I'm curious what people would say. I feel
you're going to get a very skewed answer there because they're on YouTube. What do you think?
But I don't think you can be, you know, I think you can do both. I'm sure there's a lot of people on YouTube that would order a book off of Amazon or,
yeah.
You know.
I want to be a New York Times bestseller.
Yeah.
I didn't realize it takes 10,000 copies to be a New York Times bestseller.
Okay.
So,
I didn't
like,
know that.
Yeah, so you would be able to say you'd sell 10,000 copies, which I have no doubt you'd be able to do. New York Times bestseller.
Wait, I thought it was also based on like reviews and things like that. I mean, I have no idea, but
I thought it was just 10,000.
It would make
sense.
Find
this out. This is crazy.
Google.
Wasn't it Colin and Samir that told us that?
Yes, maybe that was it. Yeah. You have to sell 5 to 10,000 copies of a book in a week.
But okay. 5 to 10?
Yeah, what if you sell more?
If you have a link or something that we could put in the description, people could pre-order.
Oh, cool.
Or maybe give their email. Whatever you have set up, we'll link to that.
Thanks. I'll see if that's possible. Mm-hmm. Appreciate that.
What are the things that you came here wanting to discuss? Is there anything that you want to talk about?
Or questions for us?
My biggest thing coming in, I was really curious about the house thing. And if you would sort of urge me to get a house. I was looking for advice on that.
I would stay renting. I've been telling Jack this too. Jack wants to buy a house right now. First of all, I think for you, it doesn't make sense. I think for you mentally to lock yourself into a house like that. I think you would benefit from having that mobility of being able to say, okay, you know what? I'm tired of this lease. It expires in 2 months. Let's go get a house in Topanga for a year or two. I'm tired of that. Let's go move somewhere else. I think having that mobility for you right now is really important.
Yep.
Having a house, I think, would lock you in. And prices and inventory right now are just insane. Right. I'm looking at the prices today, and I've never thought of selling before. I'm tempted. There was a triplex. I was thinking about selling, thinking about it. And I've never said that before. I've always wanted to keep everything forever. It's just the values have gotten to a point where they're so high that I feel almost like irresponsible for not cashing out.
So then what's holding you back?
What else I would do with that money? Okay. It's like, and also taxes. Whatever I sell, I'm going to pay the top tier taxes plus 13.3% to California. So like the triplex, for instance, let's say capital gains stay exactly the same. I'm paying 20% capital gains, 3.8% net investment tax on top of that, then 13.3% to California. Mm. So right off the bat, then more than a third of my profit on that is gone. Does it make sense? Probably not. I don't think values are necessarily 30% higher for that to make it worthwhile to sell. But then of course you could 1031 exchange it to something else. But then it's like, well, if I buy something else, I don't want the stress of then finding another place to buy.
Hmm. That makes sense.
Yeah. I agree with that. I think it's smart for you to rent.
Yeah. So
I'm thrilled.
Yeah. This place too, it's like, I don't live in it. We don't live in it enough to justify keeping it, but it's like, we like it so much and it's great to have a place to come back to.
And then just through the course of the interview, well, I'm still curious about the dating thing, really.
Feel free to listen.
Off the record, maybe. I don't know. I find it fascinating.
On the record's better.
you can ask whatever you want.
We got to monetize this, at least.
Sure.
I just want answers. I don't know why things aren't clicking. I don't know what's...
I'll tell you what.
Is it the location? Is it...
No.
Have you dated in other cities?
No. I'll tell you why. Jack, I think, is too logical.
Yeah.
Too serious.
You're right.
He's not letting loose, and I don't think he's putting himself out there enough. That's what I think.
I'm not very serious, I don't think. I feel like I'm extremely relaxed. And I'm
on these dates.
Maybe not on the dates, but in general.
Listen, I've kind of eyeballed Jack on dates. It's in my opinion, a little too stiff. A little too
maybe
rigid.
Maybe I do get a little nervous.
A little rigid.
When I'm talking to girls. Yeah.
I feel like that's reasonable. Like, it makes sense to get nervous. But then when you said that, I think we were talking about what you talk about or something, you're like, I don't know or something.
Well, I never treat them poorly. So no. If I'm nervous, at least I treat them well. And I hope that that's enough maybe for a second date, you know?
I heard a story recently. I'm going to put Jack on the spot.
The nerves, the little fists.
No, I was just cracking my knuckles.
Okay. Yeah,
because I don't know whether that's a... I'm just going to
tell it.
I'm going to say it's Kelly. And apparently Kelly was wearing some boots that were very uncomfortable walking down the Las Vegas Strip. Jack offered his shoes. Did this happen?
Yeah, dude. She was complaining about her feet, and I thought they were hurting.
His shoes, the size 10 or 11 shoes that he's offering to Kelly, who's probably a size, I don't know what size her feet are, 6 or 7, I'm guessing.
I don't understand.
That's nice. I mean, it's nice.
But is that serious? Weird? But he was serious. It's funny to be like, you can wear my shit. But to be serious.
I just don't. I don't understand why that's so weird.
It's odd.
Really?
Yeah.
I don't know. It doesn't click with me. I feel like I have some wire in my brain, where I can't understand that. Yeah.
I feel that way about certain things. I feel like there's some things that I'm just on the outside of. I'm like, how did certain social... I grew up homeschooled and Mormon, so kind of certain things that I feel like I just don't understand socially of how you go about. I don't know. I was definitely nervous coming here today, and I was like, oh.
Really?
Yeah.
Why? Gosh,
we were nervous.
We were nervous. We wanted to make sure it went well.
No, I've been so happy. But the first five minutes, when I was here, I was like, oh God, okay. Why am I nervous?
Why?
Because of socializing with one person at a time, I don't feel nervous.
Yeah, sure.
One person at a time, I feel like there's something in that where it's just like, it's clear that you go back and forth. Mm-hmm. But when there's more people, it's like, well, which one? How do you talk?
Yeah, I get that.
And I feel like
that.
I kind of short circuit. And it genuinely feels really difficult, you know, to go into those settings and to know how to navigate when there's multiple people around. And I find it somewhat stressful. But you guys have been so welcoming and nice. So thank you.
Yeah. We're just so happy to have you
here. Yeah. My biggest thing I would say for stuff like that, because I've Jack has told me that I've been not always the best host. And for me, sometimes too, I need my space.
Okay.
It's like sometimes if I talk too much or like, this is fine. But if I'm doing this all day for like 4 days in a row, I love having my own space and just time to myself, whether that be just like being in my office by myself or just, you know, looking at the aquarium by myself. No one's talking to me, no nothing, no distractions.
Yeah.
So sometimes when guests come out, like I'm already like my brain is fried and I'll just, I need to be by myself.
Yeah.
But I think some people say it maybe I don't like them, which is not the case. But
I'll put you on the spot.
Yeah, sure.
There have been not one, but more than one occasions where people have came over to our house and then they brought me aside and they say, I don't think Graham likes me.
Really?
Yeah, I felt terrible because it's not, I like every guest we've ever had on the podcast, every single one of them. I don't think there's one guest that came in here that I was like, I don't like them.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah. Has there been? No, I don't think so. Everyone I'm trying to think. There's like, is there one person I wanted to leave? No.
Do you have a guest every episode?
Yes. Okay. Now we do. In the beginning, we didn't.
Gotcha. Right. Mm-hmm. But yeah. No. When Jack told me that, I felt terrible because I totally see that. But there's sometimes people come over. And I'm just like, I've been nonstop. I've had zero time to myself.
Yeah.
And I can't do it. I don't have the energy. And so for me, it's like, well, I just want to be like in the corner on my phone, just doing my thing for like 30 minutes an hour.
That's understandable, though. I feel like.
But yeah, but I agree. When someone comes to the house and I'm doing that, I agree. That's something when Jack told me that, I felt really bad and I acknowledge that.
I'm curious about one other thing. Your emotionality, you don't think you're emotional. You think he's emotional. Is that correct?
Yes.
You don't consider yourself emotional.
I don't. I know I get bummy. If I have a bad video, it doesn't perform well. I'm like, what did I do wrong?
Yeah.
We can't fix it. I get bummy with the fish. If I have a fish that's not doing well, I get really sad. That's it. Sometimes it's like time pressures. Like if we're short on time, I was like, we just got to get it done. We got to get it done. I don't have time for that. Like stuff like that.
Yeah.
I think you react a lot. He has very high emotion reactions to certain things. And that's okay.
I don't think I do.
You do. Dude, I showed up late here today because I said I would show up at 12.
But that's funny.
Oh, I feel like you're serious though sometimes, like rooted in the humor.
I would
like,
say there's 20% serious. I told Jack to get here at 12. He showed up at 12:30. I'm like, Jack, you're late.
I didn't show
up
at 12:30. I showed up at 12:17, 18, but I went to the guest unit.
All right, whatever. Showed up late. And I'm like, Jack, you're late. You're late. And he's like, there's traffic. I'm like, you got to plan for that. You got to plan for traffic. It's like, oh, it's so bad. There's a car stopped on the freeway. I'm like, there's always a car stopped
on the
freeway.
Dude, it was stopped in the freeway. It was always stopped on the side. It was in the middle of the freeway.
Every time there's going to be a car. Was
this was the
101.
It took a while.
Oh, okay. 405.
Yeah.
It's always a car stopped there. It's the 405.
In the middle of the freeway? Yes, it's on the side.
Like, you showed up right on time. Like, perfectly on time within, like, a few minutes.
Thank you. I left with plenty of time. I'm a nervous driver, so I, like,
When we need to go somewhere, believe it or not, I'm usually the one. Alex can attest to this. Who's at the door first? With plenty of time to spare. Okay. And then it's Graham.
I find the emotionality thing interesting because I feel like I feel like when people hear about emotions, they assume the person is like unprofessional or something. But I feel like sometimes people who have a certain emotionality are the most professional because that's part of what drives that. Like that's something that's, because if you're quick to react to certain things, there's also that underlying emotion that's compelling you to do the thing and that's driving you and that is passionate and that's, is this making sense?
That makes sense.
That's a great answer. Perfect. That's what I meant to say.
I always think back to this when I try to understand why Graham is as successful as he is and why he's as emotional.
100%.
And
100%.
There was one specific thing that happened. You and me and Biaheza were all together. Biaheza is another finance YouTuber.
Okay.
And Graham had a poorly performing video.
Yeah.
And Graham was getting mad. Yeah. And it was weird. I felt weird in the room because we had a guest that we just brought over, and Graham's getting all.
Oh, I remember this.
Graham
was
like, "Oh, is it the thumbnail? Is it the title?" And he's like, "Oh, what's going on? What's going on?" And it was like really tense. And I was like, "Be a little more welcoming if we have a guest here." And then Graham got up and left, and I was like, "I told Vlad because I was like, dude, I'm really sorry. Like, I know that was probably like weird because you just arrived here as soon as we were posting, and it didn't go well. Sorry about that." And he's like, "I get it, man. That's why he's so successful."
He said that.
Yeah.
He's so nice. But in my defense, I felt like I knew him already. We had been talking like loosely on YouTube for like a year.
Sure.
So by that time, I felt like we're already friends.
There's a rapport. So it's like,
exactly. Totally. And he's in YouTube, so he knows. Like, I feel like if anyone understands it, it would be him. Mm.
So that kind of like, it made me understand that those actually work well together.
Mm-hmm. Oh my God.
The fact that you get emotional about the work that you do.
Absolutely. I think if you don't, it shows in the work. I think it's impossible. You can't, I don't know how a person can be successful if they're not absolutely driven to do the thing and there's not that emotional core underneath it. Well, it's going to be watered down. They're not going to care. It's going to be lazy. Like, it's horrifying.
I agree. That makes sense.
Yeah. See, that's the thing. You only have emotion for things you care about.
Yes.
If you're indifferent, you wouldn't have it. You wouldn't have an emotion anyway.
Right.
Yeah.
What are your thoughts on college?
I did not go. My a couple of my brothers went, and I was always under the impression that that would be kind of expected of me, junior college, because that's much more price friendly. But I wanted to go to film school because at that point I'd already really, really wanted to write and direct. And then I thought, well, I don't think it makes sense because the whole point, like what a lot of people are doing are kind of like networking with people that are also interested in what they're doing. And I already know a lot of people in the film industry. I'm already in the industry. The career is somewhat adjacent to acting. It just makes more sense to not, like, it doesn't, if I wanted to study something, there are certain things that I think it makes sense to have a degree for and to go to college for. And there's certain things that I'm like, I think it just makes more sense to get experience on the ground. And writing and directing was one of them. So I just kind of took the money that I would have spent toward college and I put that toward making my own short films. And I think I learned way more than I would have by just going through the motions of that kind of in college.
I agree with that. And colleges aren't up to date either necessarily. Like, I think you could make an amazing career on YouTube.
Yeah.
And just even producing your own content. And there's so many different ways to get into that industry.
Totally agree.
What would you say are the things that you are most passionate about in your whole life? Like,
helping people grow, growing myself and also helping other people grow, whether that's like my friends and having thoughtful conversations, or whether it's my favorite thing about directing is watching when actors like surprise themselves when they like reach some emotional place they didn't know they could go to, and seeing them be so kind of in the moment, like even talking about it now, I feel emotional about it. I think it's so cool to see people come to new like levels within themselves. So I guess just growth is probably the biggest thing. What about you?
The things I'm most passionate about?
Yeah.
Family, friends, and work.
Well, I guess I like taking care of the environment. I'm pretty passionate about that.
Oh, yeah. Really? We should tell people not to use straws.
Guys, so, don't use straws.
So here's something. So I had, you'll see this on Sunday if you watch it. This is one of my favorite episodes of the Iced Coffee Hour.
Yeah.
I confronted my first boss ever, who gave me a chance in like everything. I was like 12, 13 years old, took me under his wing. This is when I was at this basically aquarium store.
Yeah.
And I had not seen him in 14 years. Flew him into Las Vegas, confronted him, and it was such a cool experience. But his one thing for me is like, if I can ask one favor of you, because he's obviously he's in the aquarium industry, and so he sees the damage that's being done, is to give up plastic straws. He's like, if I could ask one favor, I'm like, absolutely. Like, I would gladly, that's like the least I could do.
Yeah.
So now, like, I would encourage you guys, like, if I've helped in any way or you enjoy this, it's so easy to do.
Yeah.
And people are like, but Graham, that's only 0.1%. And like, I get it. It's not a huge part of the pollution, but it's the lowest hanging fruit that people could do. It's just plastic straws. It's so easy to do. And that's why for me, it's like, wasn't even an issue. So yeah, but sea turtles mistake them for food. And then they eat them, and they can't digest them, and then they leach plastics into the water. So if you can, go to bamboo instead, or the metal straws.
Mm-hmm. I use the metal ones. Yeah. Got a set of them on Amazon for like $6.
Yeah. See? We got bamboo straws, a whole bunch of them. So that's what I'm using now.
I have plenty of metals if you need any extra metals.
Cool. So that's it. That's my little spiel.
So where do you want to grow then?
Where do I want to grow?
Yeah.
You mean which areas, or you mean
which areas
what
do you
specifically?
Grow?
I would like to... A thing that I'm currently working on is I have bitterness about my past, and I mentioned not really feeling entirely grateful, and I want to work on that. Not that I want to work toward, like, I think it can be forced to try to work toward a thing that's not genuine. Like, I think it's so easy to say, like, oh, and I'm so grateful for my journey. Like, thing is just useless. Like, okay, it just sounds like lies. But just to, I think bitterness is a good thing to work on. I don't want to be a bitter person. I don't want that to infuse my life moving forward. So I think it's something I should work on.
Yeah. I want to be more carefree. I think that would be nice. A little looser sometimes. I think little surprises that come up, I don't handle this well. I like things to be planned in order. I want to know what I'm doing tomorrow at like 10 a.m.
Yeah.
And like doing exactly that and sticking on schedule.
Yeah.
So I could be a little bit more, Not impulsive. What do you?
Spontaneous.
Spontaneous. That's a good word. Spontaneous. We could save this for a part two. If you're down for a part two, we could do a part two episode. Because sure. I'm worried this is going to be too long.
Just a Jack interview. Yeah.
You're always welcome to like come back on.
Yeah. Preferably. No, this has been so fun. If you want to come to Vegas, you and your boyfriend come to Vegas, you would have a blast. Stay at Red Rock Casino. It's not on the Strip. It's really nice. And we're like 5 minutes away from there. You would have a great time. And are you into hiking?
I love hiking. My partner loves hiking, except the heat. I don't think.
You would be going during the worst time, unless you go early in the morning. Like if you went from like 6 to 9, it'd be fine.
Cool. Mm-hmm.
But yeah, we'll do a part two where you could. How about Jack? You implement all the changes, and then we'll report back, and we'll do a part two in like a few months.
Yeah,
go on a couple dates, give us some info,
get married.
There you go.
Yeah. Elope in Vegas. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Elvis, cool.
Thank you so much, Jennette, for coming.
Yeah, thanks for having me. This has been a blast.
Thank you so much. Yeah, make sure. Before we end, to tell them to smash the like button.
Smash that like, this guy? This one? With the ring light?
No, that one right there.
Oh, that one.
Smash that like, the like button, like right down below.
Smash that like button.
Then and say subscribe. Destroy it. Destroy it.
Can you please destroy the like button already? Goddamn.
Oh, wow. Oh. That's passion. We'll bleep a little bit of that there. So with that said, you guys, thank you so much for watching. I really appreciate it. As always, make sure to obliterate the like button, subscribe, hit the notification bell. All of our information is down below in the description, where you could also get a free stock now worth all the way up to $70.
Wait, how much?
70.
No.
Did you get your free stock worth all the way up to $70 on public?
Wow. No.
It's impressive. Yeah. And you could follow me in there because I'm posting all of my own stock trades. So if you're curious what I'm buying, down below in the description, enjoy that free stock. Thank you so much for watching, and until next time. Well, that is like half cream, so.
I can't go wrong. So you can 72,000.
Yeah.
And do you want me to say the cent amount as well?
Yeah.
Can I keep this here?
Yeah. Okay. You can reference that.
Cool.
Whenever. Mm-hmm.